Hey, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to this instruction course on cerebral visual impairment. I think it is the future challenge, and I think all of us will really enjoy the session and take back some learnings. And of course, we can also teach amongst ourselves what more do we add to this important problem which is there now. So I'll be speaking on the why is CVI becoming so important in India. In India, with improved management and the survival of children affected by brain injury due to perinatal insult, metabolic disorders or trauma, it is becoming the cause of visual impairment in our population itself. Last four years, we've seen around 256 patients, and now we find that in 1 year, we have seen around 272 children with CVI. So just in 1 year, we have seen such a large population of children with CVI. And this is now becoming one of the most commonest cause of visual impairment. And we do see that in our clinic every day about this, that these children with CVI are coming, and most of them are being referred so late. So what exactly is CVI? Cerebral visual impairment is deficiency in the function of vision due to damage or maybe malfunction of the visual pathways or of visual centers in the brain, especially posterior to the lateral geniculate body. So here we have the occipital cortex. If there's damage here, or the parietal lobe or the temporal lobe and the interconnecting pathways, we find that it's not only the vision which is affected, but significant visual difficulties are seen because of this. Now, how do we differentiate in our clinic from just ocular visual impairment? We find that, do we know that this child has CVI or not, or what is the problem? So you know that CVI is an umbrella term which is covering a range of visual difficulties. It may be a child with very impaired visual impairment or can have even a normal visual acuity. So how do we differentiate? They would have a normal eye exam unless they have associated cataract or squint, but they will have a normal eye examination. And what we find is that all the visual, like the refractive errors, we correct them with refractive errors. We do all the squint correction or even the cataract. We find that they are still, the results are subnormal. So we find that they have some visual behavior problems. There may be a latency. They may not respond to your visual commands, to your commands, what you give. And light gazing behavior is seen in some of these children. There could be associated motor, sensory, cognitive, and behavioral difficulties. So now what we have to understand is only seeing, is seeing and vision the same? It is not the same. What happens after the image reaches the brain? We have three stations: the occipital lobe, the posterior parietal lobes, and the temporal lobe. So what does the occipital lobe do? It is like the printer. So it gives you the clarity of the picture, like visual acuity, the color, the shades of gray, like contrast sensitivity, and also the visual fields. So what happens if it is damaged? We'll have poor clarity like this. We'll have contrast which is poor. We'll have field defects. Like in this case, there will be a, this is what the patient is seeing, like a right homonymous hemianopia. Now in the station two, when it is the posterior parietal lobe which is affected, it is the mapper and the doer. So basically, it helps us to analyze the visual scene, and it gives us attention to a particular object of interest. Like, see, we have Arjun here who is aiming at the bird, and his only attention is at the bird. So it also helps us to visually guide our movements. That's like when the child walks up and downstairs holding on. It also analyzes the whole scene and chooses to give attention to one object. Suppose you want to just see the pencil. There are a lot of things around, and you want to only want to see the one pencil. It tells us about that. So this is what is the function of the posterior parietal lobe. So that's why we are not able to see if the child has damage to the posterior parietal lobes. It will all able to process multiple visual objects in the surrounding. So it will only see one object, which is called as simultanea. Or see here, you can see the child is not able to see the visual field, lower visual field. So he'll have difficulty in climbing down the steps. Or he will overshoot in a particular object, like here, which we'll have impaired guidance of movement, which is called as optic ataxia. So all these will be seen if there's damage to the posterior parietal lobe. So what happens if to the temporal lobe if it is damaged? So it is the what, like it helps us to recognize the colors, the shapes, objects, route finding, recognizing facial expressions. So if it is damaged, we'll have prosopnic agnosia. That means we are not able to recognize a face. Okay? Or you can have difficulty in recognition of objects, shapes, like letters or numbers. So, and it also will have difficulty in route finding. So these are the many problems what we see when these children come to us. So vision is not just visual acuity 6-6. It is seeing and processing it. Like suppose now that there's a pen. When the pen was picked up, the dorsal stream passed the whole visual scene to the parietal lobes. Okay? And then it was given attention. So parietal lobe tells us, okay, this is a pencil, give attention to it. It recognizes through the ventral stream, okay, this is a pencil. Okay, the frontal lobe says, okay, choose to pick up or not the pencil. And the dorsal stream then instructs the motor cortex that, okay, now you reach the pencil, how far to reach, how to grasp it, how to hold the pencil, and then the task was accomplished. So imagine it's such a complex process, and imagine if there's a damage to this process, and that is what exactly we see in CVI. So this is what is CVI, where it is not only the vision which is important, it is the full processing which is occurring, which has got damaged. So we see that the most common causes in our clinic is hypoxia, traumatic brain injury, infections of the CNS, neonatal hypoglycemia, seizure disorder, metabolic condition or maternal intake of drugs. We also have acquired causes. So this is, if you have a pathogenesis, like if it is in the late second to third trimester, it's basically, it is a hypoxia to the subcortical area, which is called as periventricular leukomalacia. Or if it is, we get a term baby, and if it is in the watershed zones, we get a encephalomalacia, which involves both. So our data shows that basically 90.9% had an eventful perinatal period. Preterm delivery was positive in 37.5% patients. And most common cause was infections. And we've seen the cerebral palsy was also seen as the most associated factor in 19.3% patients. So now how do we have to tell people that, okay, because many of them are presenting so late, we got it like the children are coming at so late to us. So what are the red flags to detect? So red flags are if at 2 months, say within birth to 8 weeks, no eye contact, 3 to 4 months, no social smile, no awareness of hands by 3 to 4 months, if there is squinting, or at 6 to 7 months, not reaching out to any objects, not recognizing faces by 7 to 8 months, and if they're just pointing at a particular, not wanting to hold that particular object. So when you're not able to put small things into a container, does not point finger when named. So all these are important things to pick up, okay, this child, there is a problem, not able to process, and that's how we should, these are the children who need to be thought of as CVI. So now I would like to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Sovita. She works with SCH as a consultant in the Department of Pediatric Ophthalmology, Strabismus and Neuro-Ophthal. And she underwent a post-graduation at L.B. Prasad Eye Institute. And she will now talk on ophthalmic manifestations and assessment of these in CVI children. By the time she sets it up, we can discuss some questions. Okay, and our next speaker again, we have with us Dr. Meenakshi Swaminathan, all of us, I think there's no need of any introduction for ma'am. She works as a senior consultant, as pediatric ophthalmology consultant at Shankar Netralay. She's also the director of academics there. She has trained at PGI, Chandigarh and the US, and she is also representing the ICO at the AIC's teaching program in the ophthalmology program. She's also an examiner of the FRCS. She's my very good friend. And she will be speaking on what I just said, the higher visual deficits and how to correlate them with MRI defects and how to assess the higher visual defects. And one more speaker, I think another dear friend, Mrs. Madhumati Bose, who works in the field of early intervention for children with developmental delays and disabilities. She has 26 years professional experience in this field. And at Shroff Charitable Eye Hospital, she involves herself in early stimulation and intervention for these children with cerebral visual impairment and multiple disabilities. She is an international level trainer and has conducted a number of workshops in India, Bangladesh and UK. She will be speaking on early intervention strategies and a few success stories. So any questions from the audience? Okay, I would like it to be more interactive, this instruction course, because we are all learning. And if any questions, please...